Are you ready for Pentecost? Amen. The last 7 weeks, we've been preparing you for this moment in time. Amen. Last week, we had 35 people come up. Half of them had wounds because of their earthly fathers, and now their perspective of the heavenly Father was developed through their earthly father, and so those chains came off of them, and they were set free and liberated. And then half of them were mother wounds, people that were raised by mothers but never had a motherly touch or motherly comfort, motherly encouragement. They came forward, and they got set free, and I'm telling you, chains hit the floor. So 35 people came forward, all in preparation for this day. Amen. Also, we've given, in this series, we've given over 550 of these little books about the Holy Ghost. So you've taken 550-something books, these books, and I don't know what you're doing with them. Hopefully you're reading them, and hopefully it's preparing you for what's going to happen today. I'm so thankful to be a part of what God is doing today in this moment, that we are on the edge of the move of God. We're not stuck in the past. We're not static. We're not sedentary. We're not stuck in the law. We're not stuck of what God used to be doing, but we're moving in step with Him. Amen. In step with Him. So the Pathpoint family has been honoring a kingdom pattern for 7 weeks. In fact, we've been talking to you about a kingdom, these kingdom patterns that are just below the surface found in Scripture, but we've been training you to have an eye for what that kingdom pattern looks like. We've used several examples. Jesus said, "I'm the way, the truth, the life." So He was telling us this is the kingdom pattern. He showed us the pattern of darkness is the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. So we're recognizing these kingdom patterns. One such pattern that we're really honoring is something that started on Resurrection Sunday, went through Passover. Today is Pentecost. Tomorrow is Jubilee, 50 days. 50 days. Now, this is not coincidence that God did this at a time when this is the busiest time of the world. This is the busiest time of the year, isn't it? Graduations? Huh? This, that, and the other? This doesn't surprise God. He did this on purpose. 50 days. Today's Pentecost, tomorrow Jubilee. Just a brief explanation of Jubilee is this. It means all debts are forgiven. All prisoners set free. So whatever you've been captive to, you're no longer held in captivity. Amen. Amen. Now see, we believe this is a spiritual law that's passed through the centuries to this century, to our generation. And this is why we're not only observing it, we're honoring it. We recognize that this is a set time of the Lord's favor. And here's what the Holy Spirit said to us coming into this series, and you heard me mention this. He said, if my people will honor this set time, He said, they can expect to receive newfound freedoms. They can expect to receive new physical strength suddenly. In other words, things they haven't been able to do for 10 or 15 years physically, they're going to be able to do. That strength and that energy physically is going to be restored back to them. He said, you can expect, tell your people, expect to receive financial increase suddenly. It's just going to happen. Don't try to figure it out. It's just going to happen for you. Amen. And then He said, tell your people, expect to receive newfound favors suddenly. There are going to be people that just want to do you a favor. They want to just help you out of your situation. They want to just reach over to you and say, what can I do for you? And they're going to do it suddenly. Don't try to figure it out, saith the Lord. Just remember, I promised you it. I promised you this, and it will come to pass. Amen? Now, as we've talked about and established this idea of kingdom patterns, we've come to learn this, that kingdom recognition, or should I say pattern recognition, raises our spiritual IQ. And then, through that spiritual IQ, it awakens us to discernment so that we no longer see through our own perspective, but we see through the Holy Spirit's perspective. This is liberating, because what happens when you're in a negative situation, but you see it the way the Holy Spirit does instead of the way you normally see it? Huh? Instead of reacting, now you're responding the way He would have you respond. This is freedom, because now you can hinge all your decisions in that negative situation. If you're looking at it through the Holy Spirit's perspective, you can look at that and go, okay, that's on you, Holy Spirit. That's on you, Holy Spirit. And that's right where He wants you to be, depending upon Him. This is how we reign over instead of getting run over. We're no longer feeling our way through the day. We're discerning our way through the day. And we're doing this one day at a time, and it is a choice, a decision that has to be made. Amen? Now, if you've been here the last 7 weeks, you've learned more about the Holy Spirit than most Christians hear in a lifetime. That's the truth. You've learned, they hear. But you learned it in 7 weeks. You've discovered in this 7 week period that the family of Pathpoint honors the Holy Spirit, but not in name only. We honor the Holy Spirit by allowing Him to fulfill His ministry assignment through the demonstration of His power. We're not calling the shots here. He's calling the shots. We're not telling Him what to do. He's telling us what to do. We're not taking lead. He's leading us. Amen? And this is the journey of every Christian, or should be, to learn and to discipline ourselves in this process, on this kingdom path. Now look at what Jesus said in Luke, the 24th chapter. He said, "Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with power from on high." Now, the promise is not a what. This promise is a who. This promise is the Holy Spirit. Amen. And so what did these 120 do? They did go to Jerusalem. They went to the upper room. For the next 10 days, they're going to wait. They're not twiddling their thumbs, however. They're not just passing time. No, what are they doing? They're getting right with God. They're judging themselves. And they're getting right with one another. And if we do the same thing, the Holy Spirit's presence would show up in our midst every Sunday. Get right with God. Judge. You know, I don't need to repent. Well, you need to repent for not repenting. Tell your neighbor, you're smart. You're wise. See, we're a wise group of people. Amen? In other words, we see beyond the obvious. We see what other people can't see. We see what the religious people that are blinded, they can't see. Amen? We're not doing this out of obligation, duty, ritual. We're doing this out of relationship with God, Jesus, and? Say it out louder. Say it louder. The Holy Spirit. Amen. This is what we're doing. And so there they are. And suddenly, there came a sound from heaven. King James Version says it was the sound of a rushing mighty wind. Another translation says it was roaring. Here's what I want you to take from this, however. This was not a sound of this earth. This sound originated in heaven. And the only thing they could compare it to was wind. But it wasn't. It was from heaven. Amen. It was from another world. And it came down and filled that room where they were sitting. And suddenly, like we saw in the video, swarms of fire. Swarms of fire. They only knew how to describe it as tongues of fire. But it was a swarms of fire, see? And they were endued with power from on high. Acts, the second chapter, verse 4. What does it say? And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak in tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Did you read that just like I did? Do you see that that's what that says? At a time when Jerusalem was a melting pot of many ethnic groups, many tongues, many dialects, many languages, many cultures, Jerusalem was a place where all over the world they came to trade there. And all this commotion is happening on the street, but what's happening in that upper room? Have you ever wondered why God put them in the upper room instead of on street level? To get everybody on street level to get their attention, to turn their eyes up, up, up. They hear that sound coming out of that room. Are you listening? They see the glow of that fire glowing through the windows. They hear this commotion. And they're going, I hear that person speaking in my language. I hear them speaking in my dialect. What are they doing? They're preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the word says that thousands of them came to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ that day. Over 3,000. Such as should be saved, is what it says. Amen. Now, you understand Bethlehem was a one-time event. You understand, don't you, that Calvary was a one-time event? Do you understand Pentecost was a one-time event? Yes, it was. Pentecost marks the when and the where, the time and the place where Jesus first sent the Holy Spirit. There. Amen? But here's what you need to understand. Pentecost marks the birth of the church. Happy birthday, church. I said happy birthday, church. That's the first time most of you have heard that. Hold on, you've been in church for 40 years and never celebrated the birth of the church. You didn't know the importance of Pentecost. From this day forward, because the Holy Spirit has called us into the restoration movement, he did that in 2020, and I began to teach a class on Tuesday night. And little did I know that it would turn into what our school of spiritual empowerment, where we're teaching spiritual skills for life. That's exactly what it's turned into. But it's all about the restoration movement, to restore all things that have been lost to the church, whether it's been stolen, whether it's been forgotten, whether it's drifted away, whether it's something that's just been misplaced by the church, or whether the church has said, we don't need that anymore. And the Lord has called us, and with every calling comes an anointing to restore. To restore. Why? Because the third chapter of Acts, verse 21, Jesus is restrained in heaven, not by force, but by choice, until the restoration of all things to the church. This is our responsibility. Now, if Jesus doesn't return in our lifetime, we'll hand the baton off. But let's make sure that we get much further down the path than the previous generations. I think this generation, men like Lloyd, men like Rick, men like Anthony, men like Ted, men like David, and men all across this room, and women all across this room, I believe you have it in you, the anointing to carry the torch in this generation, to push things forward past time and no longer be delayed. But having run your race, run your race for the joy that's set before you and bringing restoration to the church. We're restoring Pentecost. We're restoring the birthday to the church. Amen. Just say happy birthday, church, real loud. I started to say sing it, but we don't want to hear that. Okay. Amen. Now, grab hold of this. what the Lord is doing in our midst. Recognize what the Holy Spirit is able to accomplish, what He's able, what He's equipping us to do. And He's giving us a knowledge and a level of understanding that other generations, He may have given them that thought, but they never acted on it. But you and I are. Amen? I remember when the Lord told us to start the process of SOCI. And He said to me, and I remember standing on this very platform, 50-something people out there. And He said to me, Scott, don't be concerned. It's going to get messy. Relationships are messy. Pathpoint Fellowship Church is a petri dish. I'm going to do tests in this church, and you're going to come to team ministry. You're going to arrive at team ministry. But I know you're human. That's good news. You're going to make mistakes. You're going to fail. You're going to blow it. He said, but don't worry about that. Don't be concerned about that, because I'm leading you. And if you stumble, I'll reach down and pick you up. And if you stumble, I'll reach down and I'll pick you up. Amen? Do you see this? Now, recognize this, that God has called you out of the world to the church. You're in the world, but not of it. Quit acting like you're of it. Huh? He called you out of the world into a holy nation called the church. It's a royal priesthood. It is the body of Christ. He's called you to the body of Christ. He's called you into kingdom family, the great church of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's called you out of the world, but He had you a place to go to on the earth, a physical place. You don't have, it's not like He just called you out of the world and said, okay, we'll let you figure it out. No, He called you out of the world, but He had a place for you to go to. That's the goodness of God that did that. Now, here at Pathpoint, we like to teach, train, activate. So let me give you an activation, because what the Lord wants to do is He wants to help you change your priorities, okay, so that you develop a kingdom priority. Next time you go to someone's birthday party and you go in there and you're going to celebrate them, before you do, just inside here, just stop. And say, Lord, I celebrate the birth of the church. Happy birthday, church. And then celebrate them. Why are we doing that? So that you can become kingdom-minded all the time. Kingdom-minded all the time. Put the kingdom-minded, seek first the kingdom. This is an activation where you can put the kingdom first and then turn your celebration to that person. Amen. Now, look here at this next verse. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come. Now, recognize this sentence is just teeming with so much wisdom. Just that one sentence. When the day of Pentecost had fully come. See, what's happened is a sequence of events that had to take place. They had to be in alignment, and they had to be completed before Pentecost could fully come. So here's the Lord working behind the scenes to bring this to pass. And He's working with this series of sequences throughout time, throughout centuries. And He's bringing all those into alignment until they come to fullness, or they come to completion. And when that happens, it's like saying it this way. The one chapter ends and a new chapter begins. Let me tell you what actually happened. One era ended and a new era started. That's exactly what happened in that one sentence. When the day of Pentecost had fully come. In other words, every prophecy, every time someone stood up and preached a message and it had a prophetic word in it, every single thing, line by line, had to be fully completed. And then the Lord said, okay, now it's done. Let's move to the next chapter. Amen. So He goes on to say, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly, say suddenly, there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. You see, God works with the suddenlies. God works with the suddenlies. On the day of Pentecost, all these things happen suddenly. This was not a process of growth and development. No one taught them to do what they did on Pentecost. They didn't stand up and teach and say, now this is what we're going to do. No, this wasn't a man-made event. This was the work of God himself. Even the disciples who had been there with Jesus for 3.5 years, signs, wonders, miracles, healings, demonic deliverances, they've even been a part and participated with Jesus in some of these miracles like the feeding of the 5,000. Even they were surprised when suddenly God released the Holy Spirit upon the earth. They didn't see it coming. Because they had no idea who the Holy Spirit was and what kind of power he was going to manifest with. They were suddenly caught off guard by God once again. And God will do that in your life over and over and over and over again to where you get to a point where you'll ask the question, how did that happen? It suddenly just happened. I don't know. I guess God puts me on somebody's heart. I guess this is how it happened. But still, you don't really know. You just know it's God. Amen. It's God. He's the one that's doing the work. So here they are. I can see this happening. Oh, it's just, and it has nothing to do with a man-made event. But now, don't get me wrong, the commercialized church with all its sophistication doesn't allow for this. Because it's unscripted. It's impromptu. It's too spontaneous. No. We got to keep our hands on the reins. We got to control this. And this is why they don't allow for the Holy Spirit. Amen. But it's important that we honor the Holy Ghost in this generation. Amen. That we do his leadings and his guidance and follow him and listen to him. Amen. And not take his position or his place, but let him do what the Heavenly Father is telling him to do, and let him tell us what the Heavenly Father's told him to tell us. Amen. And just follow him. Isn't that right? Praise God. And so suddenly, God is working with a suddenly. I want you to just think about this. God wants your life experiences to be full of suddenlies. You've got to believe that. Start believing that. God wants my life experiences to be full of suddenlies. Say that after me. God wants my life experiences to be full of suddenlies. Where it just suddenly happens. Amen. I'm thinking about Jesus just as a teenage boy. He turned the water into wine suddenly. I'm thinking about when the shepherds were out tending their flocks, and it was at night, and all of a sudden an angelic choir suddenly began to sing and announce the birth of Christ. Suddenly. How about when Saul of Tarsus, he was persecuting the church. Saul would one day be, his name would be changed by Jesus to the Apostle Paul. And Jesus said to him in an audible voice, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting the church? You see, Jesus took the persecution of the church personally. Amen. And the Bible says that suddenly a light came down out of heaven, a bright light, and it blinded Saul. And the next thing Jesus told him to do, go to the house of Ananias, and he's going to give you a wisdom, and then you're going to receive your healing. This is all the suddenlies. Remember later on, Paul and Silas, they're in jail. They're going to be put to death. And suddenly an earthquake. And all of a sudden, the prison doors opened up, and there's Paul and Silas, once prisoners, now walking out as free men, suddenly. What did we find out about that? The church back over here at someone's house is praying for Paul and Silas. And the Lord answers their prayer suddenly. And when they show up and knock on the door, they have to force them to let them in. They had no idea that their prayer was going to be answered suddenly. They thought, well, maybe through the court system, they'll get out in a month or two. No, suddenly it happened. Amen? Expect the suddenly. Whatever you're stuck in today, expect the suddenly. Expect the sudden turnaround. Expect that good news coming to you suddenly. Expect that physical strength. Don't you dismiss it because the doctor said, no, you're never gonna be, you know, you're not 20 years old anymore. Well, my body thinks it is. Amen. Hallelujah. Suddenly. Say suddenly. Expect the suddenly. Amen. I expect in this season that we're in for God to do many suddenlies in the lives of the people of Path Point. Give the Lord praise in this house, will you? Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Say all. All. All of them. Did you know what we read? We read five things here in this passage of Scripture. We see on the day of Pentecost, they were of all one heart, one mind, and one accord. They were all endued with power from on high. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost. They all began to speak in tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And they all witnessed to someone about Jesus Christ in that someone's language. All. That's how team ministry works. This is why SOCI is so important. We don't need various opinions. We don't need various philosophies and ideologies to do what the Holy Spirit has told us to do. He's never going to do this, okay? And I'm saying this. Let me just put a disclaimer here because I want you to understand that many times what happens is people come into, and I've been test tubing this for years, okay, and different occasions. And so what happens is I ask, what has the Holy Spirit said to you? Well, what has the Holy Spirit said to you? And what has the Holy Spirit said to you? And what has the Holy Spirit said to you? Now, if we're going to bring all that together, what the Holy Spirit has told various people, and we're going to bring it into one session, and one saying, well, the Holy Spirit talked to me about healing. One said, the Holy Spirit talked to me about finances. And one said, the Holy Spirit talked to me about relational restoration. And one person said, well, somebody, the Holy Spirit taught me about being filled with the Spirit. Hold on. That's not the Holy Spirit telling us to do all that. Look at them. They were all of one heart, one mind, one mind. They're all thinking the same thing. One accord. The Holy Spirit's not the author of confusion. Satan is. This is how team ministry works. All getting on the same page. Amen? Now see, we want to express our various characteristics, and you know, we're unique and we're creative and artsy and we're flavorful. We're colorful, and we want to express that. Yeah, but does he want to express that? Amen? Now, I'm teaching you, especially those of you in SOCI, just how important this is to be all together. All together. Amen? Because I got the Holy Spirit right back here pushing me to 2030 and saying, the time is short. The time is short. Press on. Press on. Move. Move. Keep pressing forward. Keep encouraging them to come on. Come on. Come on. Get along. Amen. Amen. Somebody give an amen, a loud amen. Hallelujah. Now, let's look at the Acts of the 13th chapter. Let's look at this. I want you to see something. And the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Ghost. There are many benefits to being filled with the Spirit. But one of the greatest benefits that I've come to understand is the benefits of joy. Joy is not something of this world. Happiness is. Things can make you happy. A new car can make you happy for about 15 minutes. New house, maybe 2 months. But joy is from another world. It's from another dimension. Amen. And if you've never experienced joy, happiness pales in comparison. You ought to covet it. And yet, joy is what the Holy Spirit offers to every believer. To every believer, joy. Amen. Now, the word says the kingdom of God is not meat nor drink. The kingdom of God is not a social experience. It's not about getting together and having drinks, having eating together. Huh? No, he said the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit offers you an experience of joy, of peace in your soul, in your emotions. Amen? But you need to know this. Religion can steal it from you. Religion can steal that joy from you so that you never experience it. You have to decide whether you're going to choose the path of religion or you're going to choose the path of relationship with the Holy Spirit. That's a real decision that has to be made. Amen. I choose the realm of suddenlies. And in the realm of suddenlies, here's what happens. God does what he does that I couldn't do myself. And it just shows up, and suddenly it's accompanied by emotion of joy. That joy just rises up on the inside of me. Amen. And I go, well, that is not happiness. That's not of this world. That came from the Holy Spirit himself. It's validating the result I just got. Amen. And the Lord wants you to have those experiences. He wants you to. He wants your life to be full of the experiences of the suddenlies that are validated by the joy that rises up on the inside of you when that result happens. Amen. It'll turn your frown upside down when you do this. Amen. Now, Paul puts this together and explains it in more depth in the 5th chapter of Ephesians. And be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Now notice what he said, not speaking to someone else. He's saying speak it to yourself. In psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, making melody in your heart to the Lord. Now, what the world offers you is a rhythm, is a beat. The kingdom of God doesn't offer you that. It offers you a melodic song. No rhythm, no beat. It's just a melody. There's no rhythm, no beat. Are you listening? This is just a melodic song. And it's rolling down around here, and you're speaking to yourself, singing to yourself in that melody. And you can't shake that melody for anything. That melody is rolling all over and over on the inside of you, and this is how you know you're filled with the Holy Spirit. You're speaking to yourself, and everybody that's pulling up by you at the light are going, what's he doing? Well, no, at least I'm not looking at my phone. No, I'm singing to myself. I'm speaking to myself. But here's a question. Have you let religion rob you of that song? Have you let religion rob you of that kind of experience? Well, they robbed you blind when they did. They robbed you blind. It's one of the greatest experiences you can have on the earth. Did you let wrong feelings rob you of that song? Because things weren't going the way you wanted to relationally, or things weren't going the way you wanted to in your life, and it robbed you of that song. I'm telling you, that song will just take you right up above that certain negative circumstance you're dealing with. You'll find yourself singing your way out of that mess. Amen. And this is what the Holy Spirit has to offer you. Speaking yourself in psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, making melody in your heart to the Lord. Over the years, I've talked to a lot of different people, and I would ask them just put them on the spot, okay? We would be in a spiritual moment, and I would say, do you have a spiritual song? No. Do you have a hymn? Do you have a psalm? No. I put them on the spot on purpose. You know why? Because the Holy Spirit told me to. The question is this. Do you ever have a spiritual song? Do you ever have a hymn? Because I find when I have a library of spiritual songs and melodies and hymns rolling around on the inside of me. Sometimes on Saturday, Missy and I will be hanging out together, and she'll say, do you want to have music or not? And I'll say, no, because she didn't understand the music out here is going to conflict with the music in here. There's a melody going on in here. In my heart, I sing a melody. It's going on the inside of me all the time. People wonder why I can be quiet for hours. I'll tell you why, because of what's going on in my inner world. It's very, very, very loud. Amen. But what I'm talking about is for the sons and daughters of God to get over into a place where they're carrying that melodic song. And when the Holy Spirit calls them on a Sunday morning, do you have a hymn? Do you have a spiritual song? Yes, I do. Why? Because you've been singing that melody all week. Amen? What are we doing? We're growing up into Christ in all things. Amen? We're not flipping about our journey with God, our Christian experience. This is everything to us. This is everything. I went home last week and I told Missy, I don't know why I take this so seriously. I just wanted to drop the mic and walk out. Why do I take this so seriously? Huh? Did we ever come up with an answer to that? She said, not really. I just do. To me, I'm dead serious about this. I don't know why. But it's heavy, heavy, heavy in my heart to do the will of my Father. Amen. And to get the body of Christ, the church, Path Point Fellowship Church, anyone under my influence to come along, to move. Don't let those wrong feelings rob you of your song. Don't you do it. Those are wrong emotions. Where do those wrong emotions come from? Wrong thinking. You got to change that, Christian. Are you going to be stuck in the past? And the devil will rob you of your years of youth. He will rob you of your years of health. He'll rob you of your years of finances because you're stuck. Amen. He will give you all the power that he wields, but unless you're willing to stop the insanity and to reach over and tap into his power, then there's nothing he can do about it. He will offer you a garment of praise, but he won't put it on you. You have to put it on yourself. He will offer it to you. He created the garment for you, but he will not take your old coat off and put that garment of praise on for you. He won't do it. That's your choice. You have to do that. Garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Well, you just don't understand my past. That's the problem. This, Paul said, this one thing I do, forgetting those things that are behind me so I can press forward. I feel chains falling. I feel chains hitting the floor right now. I feel chains hitting the floor. I feel chains hitting the floor right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, the Holy Spirit, well, let me put it like this. This is what I've learned about my relationship with the Holy Ghost. It's a lot like a car. You know, when you get that new car, you don't drive down to the, you know, you don't leave the dealership and go down there to the filling station and fill that car up with gas one time and forever now and forevermore. You're going to drive infinitely on a tank of gas. If it's an EV, you're not going to charge that car one time. And from now on, you're just going to live on that one charge. You're going to travel on that one charge. Holy Spirit's the same way. You're not going to go anywhere on that one event. Scripture says you're going to have to keep continually being filled. You have to continually do this. Amen? Because the event is awesome. I remember many of you heard me tell this story, but some of you are new to our church. And so I'm 6 years old. I come in, and Mom's in the living room, and she's praying in the Holy Spirit. This is not foreign to me. I've seen her do this many, many times. And so I scoot over there by her, and she said, "Do you feel that?" And I said, "Yes, ma'am." She said, "Well, that's not a what, that's a who, that's a Holy Spirit." I said, because it was the greatest peace and joy I've ever felt. Peace and joy meshed together all at the same time. I'm a six-year-old kid. And she said, "Do you want him?" I said, "Yes, ma'am." And she just reached over and touched me, just like this. And when that happened, the prophetic word that Isaiah spoke thousands of years before came to pass right there in that living room floor. With stammering lips and another tongue, I'll speak to my people. It wasn't just the tongue. It was that, but it was his presence that just overwhelmed a 60, 70-pound boy. Amen. It was better than all the candy in the world. It was awesome. Amen. Now let's look. I'm going to throw a curveball at you, and I'll come back. Acts 2, verse 4. And being filled with the Holy Ghost, they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Circle that word tongues. Tongues. In the Greek, that's the word tongue, but in the English, it's the word glossary. It actually means linguistic. Linguistic. These people were speaking a foreign language that they did not understand. Do you understand? Look at verse 6. Now, when this was noised abroad, news travels fast, the multitude came together and were confounded because that every man heard them speak in his own language. So we don't have just one miracle. We have two. The first miracle was the language, the tongues. The second miracle was in the hearing. The miracle in the hearing was just as important as the miracle in the speaking. Do you see? That day on Pentecost, God sent people from all over the world to experience it. Come and experience Pentecost. Many experienced it, over 3,000 experienced it, and then many just witnessed it. The same was true today. Many are experiencing, but there's some, they're just going to witness it. And they're going to give an excuse, a justification. Well, that's okay, but it's not for me. Don't let that be you. Don't let that be you. You want the infilling of the Holy Spirit. And then as you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you want to find yourself continuously throughout the week, continuously being filled. The Holy Spirit is my best friend. He's my best friend. I hear the Holy Spirit. I speak to the Holy Spirit more than anyone else. He is my source of joy. Without him, there is no joy. I would be miserable to live with without the Holy Spirit. And Missy can tell you, when I get low on my melodic song, she can tell you, Scott, you're irritating. Why are you so frustrated? Well, I better go back to being filled, huh? Yeah, you better get gone. Amen. Now, let me finish here, and we'll just get to business. Philip was in Samaria preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thousands of people got saved. The revival broke out, and Philip knew what he needed to do next, but he didn't know how to do it. So he sent word to the apostles back in Jerusalem, and they sent Peter and John to Samaria. Okay? What did Peter and John come preaching? They came preaching the gospel of the Holy Spirit. Huh? The revival had already happened. Thousands of people already got saved because they heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. So now Peter and John are preaching the gospel of the Holy Spirit. I've never had anybody say that ever. But that's exactly what it is. It's the good news of the Holy Ghost. Amen? And so what happens? The thousands of people that got saved are the same thousands of people that got filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen? Now, there was a man there, 8th chapter of Acts, verse 18. You can just bring it up. There's a man there by the name of Simon the sorcerer. And he saw the power from that gift on Peter and John. Okay? And so he tried to buy it from them. What does this tell us about the Simon sorcerer? Well, he's bought dark crafts. Before, dark powers before. So he's thinking he's going to buy this too. And, of course, they chastise him and say, no, that's not how this happens. But he saw, here's what he saw. And when Simon the sorcerer saw that through laying on of the apostles' hands, the Holy Ghost was given. Now, some of you are going to come forward today and you're going to be given a little instruction and then suddenly you're going to start speaking in tongues. Just like that. Some of you, there's going to be a laying on of hands, and there's going to be an impartation of this relationship with the Holy Ghost, and suddenly you're going to begin to speak in tongues. Amen? It may be a stammering lip. It may be a karabakoriti, whatever dialect that is that the Holy Spirit wants to speak through you, that's you. Amen? Let him be unique to you. Let him do what he wants to do. But what I want you to see is it is God's will for me to receive the Holy Ghost. It's God's will for you to receive the Holy Ghost. Amen? And so for the last 7 weeks, we've been preaching to you the gospel of the Holy Spirit to prepare you for Pentecost, this moment in time, for you to step into a newfound relationship with God, with Jesus, through the Holy Spirit. Now, you may not understand it. You may not have your mind wrapped around it. You need to know that's okay. It's all right. Amen. You do your part and let the Holy Spirit do his part. Amen. Look at this next step. Say it with me. I'm celebrating the birth of the church. I receive you, Holy Spirit. Fill me to overflowing with all of your presence. Amen. Give the Lord praise in this house. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, every head bowed and every eye closed. Earlier this year, we did a two-part series on the Holy Spirit. 20 people came forward. The 20 people that came forward, every one of them received the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues. They got their heavenly language. Well, they're not an exception. The Lord wants to do the same thing with you. Amen. He wants us all to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. So with every head bowed and every eye closed, if you want to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, to be endued with power from on high and to speak in tongues, if that's you this morning, just raise your hand. Who in this house, raise your hand if that's you. Anybody? Okay, I see those hands all across this room. Just keep your hands up for just a minute. See those hands? Okay. Now, if you raise your hand, go ahead and stand up. Just stand up right where you're at. Go and stand right there. It takes a step of faith each time. It takes a step of faith. Amen. Just keep standing. Keep standing. Yeah. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, if you're standing, I want you to go ahead and make your way up here right now. Let's come on. Come on. You have ministers up here waiting on you. Just come and stand right here in front of them. Come and stand right here in front of someone. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, we always have a few people that are delayed. They're always delayed in their response. But the Holy Spirit is waiting here for you. He's waiting here for you to receive a gift in this new era on the day of the birthday of the church. Is an awesome experience that he wants you to encounter today. Hallelujah. Amen. Everybody in this church, just pray for just a minute. Lord, we thank you for having your way. We surrender our will to you to do the will of the one who sent us. We thank you. We thank you right now for doing the work in the hearts of the people, in the minds of the people. We thank you for a supernatural manifestation of your presence, and we thank you for an encounter with heaven today, an experience unlike any other. It's like being born again, and we thank you for this in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. We're going to just hold on for just another few seconds. If that's you today, you want to come forward, come on forward. Amen. Okay, ministers, go ahead and minister to the people. Hallelujah. 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 Everybody out there, everybody up here, just pray in spirit. Pray in spirit. Thank you, Lord. Go and sing. Sing something. Hallelujah. Let the things of this world just fade away. Take this moment in time. Think of it as a divine moment where you're encapsulated here, separated out, where the Holy Spirit can do his bidding in our midst.
No light in the darkness you see.
Hallelujah.
But just one look at the Savior.
Thank you, Lord. Come but I confess.
Just look up, heaven is on the way. Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
Hallelujah. just stand. Continue praying in spirit. If you don't have your spiritual language, just pray. Lord, we thank you. Just recently have received the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues, come on up. Come on up. Even if you just recently, in the last, this year, just come on up, Ryan. Come on, Ryan, come up. Hallelujah. He is the faithful one. I love that phrase. You turn your eyes on Jesus. Look at every problem, every circumstance, every situation dissolve in his presence. And it's simply because you shifted your focus. We shifted our focus over onto him. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. There's greatness happening up here today. Oh, the anointing of the Holy Spirit. His presence is in our midst. Woo! Glory be to God. Hallelujah. 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 Mahari kuhurisi. Shevela boru frapakovribi. Ela mavrovo sofreviti ala kundori di. Indile peria. Sevreveriti corola. Labra vasa fridi. Sorriala, o malahari verisi. Oh Lord, you are faithful. Lord, you are good. Lord, you are worthy. Lord, you are mighty. Lord, you are all in all. You are King of kings. You are Lord of lords. You're worthy of our praise forevermore. Lord, we bless you. We give you thanks. Oh, we give you praise. Thank you, Lord, the Ancient of Days. For you're more than wonderful. You're more than kind. You're more than loving, and you're all mine. You're strong in battle. You're gracious. You're merciful. And in this generation, like no other generation, we need you. We need you. We need you in this nation. We need you in the church. We need you to manifest in our schools, manifest in our government. We need you to manifest in Jerusalem, in Israel. We need you to manifest in Ukraine. We need you to manifest all around this world. We're believing you, believing you, believing you, believing in you, believing that you're doing the work, doing the work, doing the work, and accomplishing only what you can do. Thank you. Thank you for delivering us from evil. Thank you for bringing us to a new place, a new height, new anointings, new passions, new zeal and fervor for you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for lighting our fire today. And we just give you praise and glory. Hallelujah. 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 We'll give the Lord praise in this house. Hallelujah. Amen. This is exciting. This is exciting. Thank you for being a part of someone else's experience. Even if you didn't have that personal experience yourself, you were a part. You witnessed someone else experience the awesome presence of the Holy Spirit and being infilled with the Holy Ghost. Amen. Just keep this on your mind as you go through tomorrow. Tomorrow's Jubilee. Keep this on your mind. Say it out loud. I expect newfound freedoms suddenly. I expect financial increase suddenly. I expect to receive tomorrow, no later. I receive physical strength suddenly to do what I hadn't been able to do in a long time. I receive suddenly newfound favors. God puts me on people's heart, people's mind, and they want to do me a favor. They want to do something good for me. I receive it on Jubilee in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. You believe that today? Hallelujah. 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 Praise God. Make sure you tell somebody as you go to leave today, happy birthday, church. Happy birthday, church. Amen. You're the head and not the tail. You're above and not beneath. You're blessed in everything you put your hand to. Expect everything that we've been declaring today. Expect it to come to pass on Jubilee. Amen. You're dismissed. Point someone in the past.